May we request everyone to please take their seats. The Necrological Service is about to begin.
The Necrological Service in honor of the late Senator Edgardo J. Angara is hereby declared open.
Please rise for the Lord's Prayer to be sung by the UP Madrigal Singers and UP Singing Ambassadors. After the doxology, please remain standing for the singing of the Philippine National Anthem.
Thank you. ang tula at awit sa paglayang minamahal. Ang isa't tawa't mo'y tagumpay na nadidinig. Ang bituin at araw niya kailan pa may di matililim. Lupa ng araw na may ating pagsinta, may langit sa piling mo. Ang iligaya na pag may mga api, ang mamatay ng dahil sa'yo.
The Honorable Joseph Ejercito Estrada will now deliver his eulogy.
With deepest sadness, I bid farewell to my friend and colleague, Senator Edgardo Angara. I join his wife, Gloria, his son, Senator Sonny, and wife, Tutsi, grandchildren, all his family and dearest friends, in mourning the loss of this great man. We have lost a public servant of the highest integrity, a legislator with compassion, an intellectual with a heart for the poor, a champion for the cause of education. Ed was a great and lifelong believer in education as a tool to change lives. Kahit nga sa akin, pinayag niyang malaking tulong sa kabataan. Kung mararanasan lang nila mag-aral sa ibang bansa, he particularly admired the school system in London. And even said, he hoped I could send my children there. I admire Ed for many things, pero higit pa dyan. Noong at ngayon, tinuturing kong isang malaking karangalan na nakilala ko siya at naging kaibigan, si Ed Angara. I had such high hopes for our team when I chose him as my running mate in the 1998 presidential election. Alam kong maasahan ko ang kanyang katapatan, talino at galing, at maging ang kanyang hangarin na may angat ang mga Pilipino mula sa kahirapan. Salamat, Ed. Salamat sa iyong pamanang dangal sa paglilingkod at sa mga pagmamahal sa bayan. You will be missed by all who knew you and by those whose lives were touched by your generosity and commitment to serve. Goodbye, Ed, and God grant you eternal rest.
The Honorable Gloria Macapagal Arroyo will now deliver her eulogy.
Edgardo Angara was a giant among legal luminaries, an accomplished educator, and a skillful and principled public servant. He was a young delegate to the Constitutional Convention in 1971 when my father, then president of the convention, identified him as one of the young Turks destined for a bright political future. Indeed, he went on to achieve so much for so many, especially education and the economy, the farmers, and the elderly. He wore many hats, and he wore them well. On his hat as a legal luminary, a niece of mine said it all when she declared upon graduating from high school. She said, "I will work only for the best law firm. I will apply at the Accra Law Office." On his hat as educator, tomorrow, the University of the Philippines will have its reflection. And as a UP alumna, I identify with what he will say. But today, in these halls of the Senate, where Ed and I and many of us here spent 6 fulfilling years together, let me give a grateful send-off to the public servant who, to me, was a kind and mild-mannered mentor. Let me thank Ed once again that in 1992, when he was chairman of the Committee on Finance, he sponsored the Mount Pinatubo Law to provide 10 billion pesos to rehabilitate my disaster-torn region. When Ed ran for Senate President in 1993, I supported him. When he led the minority in 1995, I was one of his bloc. He called our bloc the Conscience Bloc, a very fitting choice of name that reflected the kind of principled public servant that he was throughout his life. Principle and strategic direction guided his legislation. His Congressional Commission on Education led to his well-thought-out laws, creating CHED and TESDA, and his Gaspe Law of 1998, which provided for government assistance to students and teachers in private education. Because of Ed's Gaspe, by the end of my presidency, half of private school students were government scholars. Similarly, his Congressional Commission on Agricultural Modernization led to the masterpiece, Agriculture and Fisheries Modernization Act of 1997, better known as AFMA. Ed's AFMA was the Bible for my agricultural programs. If we allocated at least $20 billion a year for agricultural modernization, it was because Ed's AFMA said that modernization should start with 20 billion pesos. If we allocated $30 billion for irrigation, 10% for post-harvest facilities, 10% for other infrastructure, and at least $2 billion for credit, it was because Ed's AFMA said so. I even appointed his protege, Ding Panganiban, as Secretary of Agriculture in 2005 to better implement his AFMA. When Ed returned to the Senate during my presidency, he was there when I needed him for my legislative tests of political will, like the anti-money laundering law which he authored. In turn, I supported his personal advocacies, like the Philippine-Spanish Friendship Day Act of 2002, and the Senior Citizens Act of 2004. And it was my honor to have him in my 2007 senatorial lineup. In 2008, he and his son, Sonny, gave us the Personal Equity and Retirement Account Law, or PERA. It was part of my economic agenda, but it also served Ed's advocacy for senior citizen retirees. Dear Ed, the impact of your principled work is larger than life, on the old and the young, the students and the farmers, the economy and education. Rest in peace and thank you.
The Honorable René A.V. Sagisag will now deliver his eulogy.
To all my golden friends gathered here this morning to bid goodbye to one we honor today and always will in his final sentimental journey home, a home of which he was patriarch for many a year. Good morning. The last few days I lost two brothers, my Kuya Tony, and also Ed, who in an email to me flattered me by addressing me as his spiritual brother. His biography in the Grand Manner was launched in late April 2015, and he was quoted there as having said that his life had been far from perfect, a phrase that Kit Tata had used today in his column in the Manila Times. It was characteristically self-deprecating, and I agree with Kit Tata, it was a life well lived indeed. Anyway, the only perfect lawyer I know, also from San Beda, Clase Superior of 1905, his name, Justice Gregorio Perfecto. If you will read the book, page 10, he said his first choice for high school was San Beda, but he was prevailed upon, I think, by an uncle to go to high school in Marikina instead. The last time we met was last March 23rd, in recognizing the 10 Pioneer Hall of Famers in the Fulbright program. He was seated with the ambassador of the U.S. In my table was a co-honoree, Cora de la Paz. And I linked them together because both of them were active in UMPREL. In fact, during the martial law years, Ed and I had very little to agree on. Although in 1971-72, during the CONCON, Abelino Cruz, my townsman from Pasig, invited me to have lunch with Ed in Manila Hotel, and Ed wanted me to be a co-founder of what later became known as ACRA. I said I'd think it over, but I declined. I had by that time founded the San Beda Free Legal Aid Clinic and took a different course. Anyway, my perception of him changed in 1985-86 when, along with Cora de la Paz, NAMPREL took a position which, like that taken by our colleague, the late Manang Leti Ramos Yahani, did not place the dictator. NAMPREL was one of the unknown heroes of the 1985-86 struggle. This impressed President Corrie and named Ed, as one of the her choices to run for the Senate in 1987. The race he won handily, and there he served for many, many years. I should add that Ed in this hall voted for conviction in 2012. And it's very unkind of some people to say that the vote was because of toxic pork barrel. Anyway, I'll avoid. Anyway, long before his autobiography was launch, we had become fast friends with a deep and abiding respect for each other's, at times differing views on what was best for the motherland. So let me conclude by reminding you of what Wordsworth once wrote. What though the radiance that was once so bright be now forever taken from our sight, for nothing can bring back the hour of splendor in the grass, of glory in the flower. Grieve not, rather find strength in what remains behind, and in the years that bring a philosophic mind. So, Ed, paalam, maraming salamat, join the nation in wishing you Godspeed for your well-deserved eternal reward.
The Honorable Pia S. Cayetano will now deliver her eulogy.
Where do I begin to tell the story of Senator Ed Angara? The stories I have of Sedja date back to my childhood when he and my father were friends and partners in Accra. He was Uncle Ed to me, and Edja, without the S for Sedja, without the P for Pedja, and we spent every summer in their beach house in Asubo. But let me start with a conversation. A conversation we had a few years ago when we were discussing our beloved UP. Both he and I had shared the Committee on Education. We had both been regents of UP. He would always laugh when I mentioned in hearings and meetings that we entered UP together, me as a freshman and he as the UP president. He'd say, "Pia, pinapatanda mo naman ako." But then I'd remind him, they were happy days because we, my volleyball teammates and I, won the UAAP championship when he was president. And for that, he gave us 1 year free tuition, all of 400 pesos per semester back then. It has never been repeated. Well, the free tuition, yes, it is now a law. But the championship, no. We remain the UAAP volleyball champions. And then we would both bask in the euphoria of that memory. And he'd say to everyone, "Parang anak ko talaga tong si Pia." But going back to my story, we were discussing education bills in UP. And I just happened to ask him how he ended up going to UP. He explained to me that a friend told him valedictorians could enter UP automatically. And he said, "Ganun ba? Eh, valedictorian ako." So he made his journey to Manila, found his way to UP, and the rest is history. He graduated from UP Law, and after that, like my father, went to the University of Michigan. It is this Provinciano boy from Baler who would later become UP president, and then a senator, and the Senate president, who passed landmark legislation, bills in education, many of which I had the privilege of working on with him. These laws are the foundation of our education today. And when I asked him just a while back on what else needs to be done, he said, "Really, it's just funding, more funding to make these policies, these dreams a reality." But it wasn't just education. In the area of maternal and infant health, one of the first bills I sponsored when I was new was my expanded breastfeeding act. He approached me when I was defending it and gave me his input. Interestingly, he was the author of the first bill promoting breastfeeding, the Rooming In Act. Later, I took on the fight to protect various national heritage sites, including the Rizal Monument. The basis was his law, the National Heritage Law. Over the years, it no longer surprised me that so many of the legislation I worked on were also his pet bills. He would be so happy that we shared the same interests. He would invite me to attend his meetings with experts in the field. I was so excited too, until I realized that he starts his meeting at 7 or 8, and even at 6 a.m. Our common interests went beyond the work in the Senate. He was so thrilled to learn I was studying Spanish. We had very long conversations about our Spanish heritage, his galleon trade project, and the need to preserve this same heritage and to strengthen our relations with Spain. Another thing that others may not know about him is his support for Philippine grassroots sports, and in particular football. He brought in Real Madrid to train underprivileged Filipino children. I happen to have two daughters who play football for UP. He always asked about them and the UP team. In fact, he has an outstanding offer for them to play in Baler. So I leave this up to Sunny. He finished his last term in the Senate over 4 years ago. But I met with him often to chat, to pick his brain, to somehow absorb the wealth of knowledge and experience that he had. In fact, we had planned a summit on English proficiency, which was supposed to happen really soon. I was in China when this happened, and my chief of staff said, Paano yung mga programs natin? Malapit na yun. And it's true, I'm sure so many people here today and in the next few days will feel that overwhelming sense of loss because this great man has left so much behind. It was clear to me that he had so much going on, from the international projects to local ones in his beloved Baler. To the Angara family, the Filipino grieve because we have lost a humble and dedicated statesman, a great teacher, my teacher, and a visionary. But my family, we grieve with you. My mom, Sandy, my brother, Alan, and I have spent much time with him. Ren, his godson, and Lino, who my father named after him. My brother is named Lino Edgardo. We grieve with you. But know this. Edja, Seja, Peja, in the many ways he was known, Uncle Ed to me, will live on through the work that we do and that of many others he has mentored and inspired.
The Honorable Aquilino Q. Pimentel Jr. will now deliver his eulogy.
It is said that power generally overwhelms the better instincts of man. Not the Ed Angara I knew. Despite the enormous powers that he had access to, or that he enjoyed especially during the early martial law years, he remained a person with balanced human perspectives. For instance, he had perks to savor, but he tried to share them with others less privileged. I know, because even if he was aware that during the martial law years I was in the opposite camp, he tried to share with me the material blessings that he enjoyed, which incidentally I had to turn down because from my narrower perspectives, I just didn't want utang na loob, among other things, to hamper the cause that I was espousing. That said, aside from the innumerable things that Ed has done for his friends, acquaintances, and supporters. His wholehearted dedication to the cause of education emerges as his unique contribution to the welfare of our people. There, in the field of education, I submit, Ed's track record as a public servant stands out over the heads of his peers. I won't mention all the laws that Ed sponsored in the course of his public life. I will limit my inputs here to only some of the laws into which Ed put his heart, soul, and mind and spirit. The creation of the Commission on Higher Education, the organization of the Technical Education and Skills Development Authority, the enactment of the Free High School Act, and the passage of the government assistance to students and teachers in private education, which incidentally is said to be the biggest scholarship program of the nation. And what was the underlying message that Ed wanted our people to know about those knowledge-sharing espousals of his? I suggest that Ed wanted our people to realize that education is the key to upward mobility that will inevitably lead to the expansion of the horizons of anyone's service and relevance to the nation. I guess Ed wanted all our citizens, and especially the poor, the oppressed and the marginalized, to realize that to extricate themselves from the clutches of poverty, they must have access to and make use of education. For once they are freed from the humanizing effects of that miserable degradation, they would then be in a position to help others enjoy fuller lives befitting human beings. As I close this tribute to Ed, may I suggest that differing opinions invariably bedevil the reputations of public servants. Divergent views, in my opinion, are a part of the democratic dialogue this country has to go through in our search for a better tomorrow. So, right or wrong, we just have to bear the contrary views as they come our way, rebut them as best we can, and let history do the rest. As for you, dear brother Ed, your focus on knowledge sharing that enables even the deprived sectors of our society to have the means to cut themselves free from the bondage of ignorance has already defined your rightful place in the pages of our history. To you then, my dear colleague, and to Glo, your dutiful and beautiful wife, and especially to Senator Sunny, who is following your formidable footprints in this august chamber, and to the rest of your family, we express our personal gratitude for the privilege of knowing you and of learning from you the invaluable, irreplaceable, and peerless contribution that education gives to our people. With your singular devotion to spread the cause of learning among our peoples, Lumads, Muslims, and Christians, we can now truly begin to relish the beneficent blessings of law and order, peace and development in this our beloved Democratic Republic. God rest you, dear Ed.
Durudu, durudu, I pray you'll be our eyes and watch us where we go and help us to be wise in times when we don't know.
The Honorable Joel Villanueva will now deliver his eulogy.
Magandang umaga po sa ating lahat. The Bible says, give honor to whom honor is due. Nakikiramay po tayo sa buong pamilya at angkan ng mga Angara lalong-lalo na po kay Tita Gloria at sa ating kaibigan, kapatid, kumpadre at seatmate, Brad Sani, Maring Tutsi. May you find comfort and consolation in God's promise. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8, the Lord said, "To be absent from the body is to be present with God." Most of all, we mourn with every Filipino as the country bids goodbye to a great leader, a statesman, a reformist, a giant wave of the Philippine Senate, the man who penned landmark laws and made a positive dent in the fabric of life of every Filipino and added rungs to the ladder of opportunity in our country. Dahil po sa inyo, Tito Ed, tunay na angara ng buhay ng mga Pilipino. Alam niyo po, ilang beses din pong akong nagkaroon ng pagkakataon panoorin ang malalaking alon sa dagat sa Sabang Beach ng Baler. Nakabibighani po ang mga alon, lalo na kapag may mga nagsasurf. Minsan po, inudyokan ako ni Brad Sani na itry ang surfing at sumampa po ako sa ibabaw ng mga naglalakihang alon doon. Lumikha po ng mga dambuhalang alon sa ating kasaysayan si dating Senate President Edgardo Javier Angara o EDJA. Mga along bumago at nagpayabong sa ating edukasyon, sining, agham at teknolohiya, governance, pamumuhunan, health at agrikultura. Thank you, Tito Ed, for the extraordinary things you did to usher in waves of change in this country. Taong 2011 po, naimbitahan ako bilang guest speaker sa Aurora Day Celebration. Siyempre po, nung gabing yon, nandun na ako sa Baler at kabadong-kabado sapagkat naghahanda ng speech the next day. Kabado hindi dahil nandoon si dating Governor Belia Angara at dating Congressman Sani Angara na mga kasamahan ko sa Kamara de Representantes. Kabado sapagkat alam kong makakasama ko si Tito Ed doon po sa entablado sa Baler Aurora. Hindi ho ako nakatulog nung gabing iyon. Pero ilang minuto bago po magsimula ang programa, bihis na bihis po ako, pero nakita ko po si Tito Ed, naka-t-shirt, naka-shorts, at naka-chinelas lang. Sa isip ko po, dapat po yata siya ang magbihis dahil siya ang ama ng Aurora. Pero nakapako pa rin po sa kanyang silya si Tito Ed at nakatitig sa isang blueprint. Nakalaunan, nalaman kong yun pala ang plano ng Baler Kasiguran Road na sinisimulan pa lamang noong mga panahon na yon. Sa sandaling iyon, nadama ko po ang gusto niyang sabihin sa akin. "Joel, don't expect me to be there with you. Hindi na sa akin importante ang palakpak ng mga tao." I walk away thinking what St. Paul said, "If I seek the applause of men, if I seek the approval of men, I cannot fully and truly serve God." At that very moment, I knew I had encountered a visionary man. Tito Ed made me experience his visions and moved me to take action. But though it was Tito Ed's visions and blueprint for the country that we will long remember, it is his friendship and generosity that we will truly miss. Nasa UST High School po ako taong 1992 when I first met in person Tito Ed Angara when they had a meeting with my father, Brother Eddie. We were on our way from Bukawi to Manila when I asked my dad, "Bakit pa magmi-meeting? Alam naman ni Tito Ed na susuportahan natin siya sa darating na halalan." At nung pong nag-meeting kami, tama po ako, isang beses lang niya nabanggit yung paghingi ng suporta. Mas binanggit po niya yung ilang mga personalidad na tumatakbo na alam po niya would make a difference in this country. And so he wanted us to help them. I also saw Tito Ed's giving heart when I ran for the Senate. I was ranking number 42, 2 years before the election. Yun po yung survey. At syempre, kumukonsulta po ako kung kani-kanino. At syempre, hindi ko po makakalimutang kumonsulta sa aking idolo kay Tito Ed. Alam ko po na walang dahilan para pagbuhusan ako noon ng personal na oras ni Tito Ed. Dahil napakababa po ng chance ako. Pero sa halip, minentor niya po ako at itinuring na parang tunay na anak. It was not the first time that I have experienced his generosity and guidance. Noong 2005, binuo po niya ang Southeast Asian Parliamentarians Against Corruption o SIPAC. Sabi po niya sa akin, Joel, you are fitting to be part of CPAC because you are the representative of Citizens Battle Against Corruption or CPAC Party List. Tinawagan niya po ako at sabi niya sa akin, Joel, ikaw lang ang naiisip kong kuhaning Secretary General ng CPAC. Hindi ko alam kung bakit. Siguro ako lang ho yung kaya niyang utusan ng 24/7. At natatandaan ko po na hindi po ako nakatanggi sa kanya dahil sa takot ko po sa kanya. At dahil na rin po alam kong hindi ako pababayaan ng aking Tito Ed. Noong panahon din pong iyon, siya rin ang naging advisor namin ng mga batang grupo sa Kongreso, sa Kamara de Representantes. At itago na lamang natin yung tawag dun sa grupo na yon na Lousy Boys. Kasama po doon si Congressman Bem Noel, Congressman Timmy Chipeco, Congressman Mujib Hataman, myself, and Senator Sani. Si Tito Ed, he really had a heart for mentoring young people. Gustong-gusto po niya na nagtuturo. Gustong-gusto po niya na nagbibigay ng advice sa mga kabataan. Dito rin po sa Senado, si Tito Ed din po ang tumatayong senior advisor ng seatmates. Kasama po si Senator Win, Senator JV, Senator Miggs, Senator Nancy, again, Senator Sani and myself. Siya po ang palaging nagpapaalala sa aming mga adhikain, sa amin pong mga pangarap para sa ating minamahal na bansa. His belief in our capacity as young lawmakers influenced us to create our personal roadmap to live a purpose-driven life and make an impact, make a difference. Ilang buwan lang po nakakaraan nung naganap po yung huling meeting ng seatmates kung saan nagkaroon po kami ng lunch meeting with Tito Ed, nagkaroon po kami ng heart-to-heart talk with Tito Ed. Mariin po niyang bilin sa aming lahat ang halaga ng pagpapanatili ng ating kultura, ng ating mga tradisyon dito sa dakilang institusyon ng Senado. For us, seatmates group, and yesterday I was talking with our majority floor leader, Tito Sen, who was saying he mentored him. Sa amin po dito, Tito Ed was the senator's senator. In our last moment with him, he gave us a challenge that reflects his deepest love for this institution, the Senate. Protect its traditions, lead fearlessly, and fulfill goals that matter to the people. Luck had nothing to do with his legislative success because he crafted laws out of his visions, his generosity, his deepest love for the Filipino people and the institution he served. Noong ma-appoint po tayo sa TESDA, siyempre si Tito Ed ulit ang aking unang kinonsulta. Nilapitan sapagkat siya ang gumawa ng mga alon para maitatag ang TESDA matapos ang EDCOM noong early 1990s. Biro ko nga po lagi sa kanya yung EDCOM, ibig sabihin Ed Angara Commission. Sa kanya ko pong unang narinig kung gaano nga ba talaga kahalaga ang TechVox sector. Sa kanya ko rin po lubos na naunawaan kung bakit marami ang bumabaliwala sa TVET. Kaya sa buong termino po natin sa TESDA, umikot sa abiso ni Tito Ed ang naging diskarte namin. Popularized Technical Education and Skills Development Authority and make it close to the people. Wala po si TESDA man kung wala si Ed Angara na tatay ng TESDA. Tito Ed, you are the soul of TESDA, and every TESDAN, every graduate whose life was transformed because of TechVox will remember and love you forever. Malaki po ang alon ng dagat sa baler kung saan isinilang si Tito Ed. At hanggang may alon, may mga nagsasurf, may mga lumalangoy doon. Subalit pagsapit po ng dapit hapon, umuwi po ang lahat ng mga surfers at manlalangoy para magpahinga, pero nananatili po ang mga alon. Wala na po si Tito Ed. Nagpapahinga na siya sa piling ng ating Panginoong Diyos. Subalit mananatiling nariyan ang mga alon ng pagbabagong kanyang ginawa para sa ating lahat, para sa ating inang bayan. Tito Ed, alam po namin na dahil sa iyong pananampalataya at pananalig sa ating Panginoong Diyos at pagmamahal sa bayan, ikaw po ngayon ay ginagantimpalaan ng Diyos dyan po sa kanyang kaharian. Sabi nga po ng Philippians 1:21, "For me, indeed to live is Christ, and to die is gain. For those of us who loved Him, and who are weeping for the loss of a father, a husband, a brother, a great leader, a mentor, a kababayan, a colleague, and above all a friend. I give you 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 to 18. And just to summarize, what it says there is that there will come a time that there will be a grand reunion in heaven. Yes, there will be a grand reunion in heaven someday. Kaya huwag po tayong mag-alala o mabalisa sapagkat balang araw may pagkakataon na muli siya nating makikita, mayayakap, at mapapasalamatan. But for now, let us continue his works and carry on so that his great contributions to our generation would not be in vain. So that the waves he started will swell, break on our shores, and straighten the wrongs that still remain in this country. Tito Ed, hindi ka po namin makakalimutan. Maraming salamat at paalam.
The Honorable Juan Miguel Miggs F. Zubiri will now deliver his eulogy.
To the family of Senator Angara, Tita Gloria, to Sunny and Tutsi, to Anna, Katya, Alex, and to all the apos and relatives, good morning. How do I put into words to describe the life of an exceptional educator, a prolific and hardworking lawmaker, a true Renaissance man, a cultural heritage protector, and one of the country's greatest statesmen? I know many of you here today would describe his different career paths and you as UP president, a distinguished lawyer who founded one of the top law offices in the country, producing several political heavyweights like Senator Drilon, Senator Gordon, the late Senator Cayetano, and Senator Raul Rocco, to name a few. Many of us know him as a former distinguished Senate President, former Secretary of Agriculture, and most recently our top diplomat representing us at the European Union. One thing for sure is that whatever post he did so with distinction and with exemplary performance. He was, without a doubt, one of the most intelligent persons I've ever met and had the extreme honor to work with. Given the chance, he could have been one of the finest presidents our country could ever have. Many of you know him as Seja. I simply called him Tito Ed. My mentor and one of the two father figures I look up to here in the Senate, the other being Senator Richard Dick Gordon. That is why in 2009, one of my most difficult moments as majority floor leader was when Tito Ed and Tito Dick had a heated argument in the session floor due to the insistence of Tito Dick wanting to give friendly interpolation to a bill being defended by Senator Angara at the time. I remember Senator Angara telling me, bakit pa magtatanong si Dick, considering the fact that they were close. And knowing the legendary tempers of Senator Ed and Senator Dick, they were going at each other in no time. Of course, as majority floor leader, I quickly suspended the session and let their tempers cool down. Unfortunately, their little spat turned their friendship into indignant displeasure and resentment, not minding each other for several days, even weeks to come. That was a very stressful time for me, as my two tatays were at odds with one another. So I reached into my trove of diplomatic skills, and one afternoon on our way to lunch, I spoke to Tito Ed inside his car and I said to him, malungkot si Tito Dick dahil hindi mo daw siya kinakausap. This softened his heart, and he then replied to me, is that so? Eh alam mo naman, Mix, mahal ko yan si Dick at dapat magtulungan na lang kami kaysa magdebate. Sige, kakausapin ko siya mamaya. I then immediately sought out Senator Gordon early that afternoon to tell him, Ninong, kausap ko si Tito Ed kanina, and he told me, mahal ka naman niya eh. At hindi naman dapat kayo makipagdebate. With this, Tito Dick then told me, really? Eh, masyadong mainit ang ulo niya eh. But sige, I'll talk to him later. That afternoon session became one of my most memorable sessions in my Senate career. Not because, for the first time, I saw an Upsilonian hug a Sigma Rowan. but because I saw two great Senate statesmen bury the hatchet, not for the good of the Senate, but for the good of their friendship. Friendship meant a lot to Tito Ed. When I entered the Senate for the first time in 2007 as a neophyte, he immediately took me in and mentored me on the ins and outs of this hallowed institution. He taught me almost all I know as a legislator in this upper chamber. Although I was already a 9-year veteran of the House of Representatives, he nonetheless taught me that it was completely different here in the Senate, how each one of the senators were unique and to an extent independent, hence the name Independent Republics. How important it was to have a bloc, hence the start of our triumvirate with Senator Richard Gordon. We were the original seatmates. But most of all, he told me to focus on passing important pieces of legislation that would make the most impact for the country. He would always pull me aside and tell me, do not waste energy mix picking fights, engaging on endless investigations, or dwelling on controversies. He always told me, mix, the quality of the legislation that you will sponsor and pass will be the one that will define you. To this day, I religiously practice that mantra of hard work, dedication, and laser focus when it comes to passing of landmark legislation. That's the Angara way. While others would love to hug the limelight in creating conflict and controversy, Senator Edgardo Angara would be mostly standing up on the floor, this floor, day after day, until the wee hours of the night, sponsoring measures like the Free High School Act, creation of TESDA, NCCA, the National Museum, AFMA, Senior Citizens Act, and so many more pieces of legislation that I do not have time to name. As well as my favorites, which I have the honor to have co-sponsored with him on the floor, which was the Renewable Energy Law and the Mindanao Development Authority Act. He authored so much high impact landmark pieces of legislation for our nation. That is the Angara way. In closing, I just want to finally share what he would confide in me in several trips together as he made me his favorite traveling companion during official missions abroad. He would confide in me that one of his biggest regrets is that he didn't spend as much time with his family. On how he wished he was there more often for his children growing up, rather than always being so focused on work. To you, Sonny, he loved you very much, and he was very proud of you. He loved his family very much, his daughters and his wife. In a way, these last few years, he tried to make up for it by spending more time with his apos and taking them to trips to make up for the lost time serving our people. Truly, he loved his family, he loved this country, but most of all, he loved this institution. Last Thursday, out of the blue, he sent me a text message to ask, Migs, how is our beloved Senate? Showing genuine concern and love for this hallowed institution that he spent close to 3 decades of his life in. All I can say to you, Ed, is that it's been an honor to have worked beside you and be mentored by you in the Senate. I am what I am here today because of what you taught me and the impact that you have created in my life. I will forever be grateful and miss you terribly. So long, Senator Ed Angara, one of the greatest statesmen of our country.
The Honorable Richard J. Gordon will now deliver his eulogy.
Baby, Sonny, and the rest of the family, my fellow citizens, colleagues in the Senate, magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat. I would tremble to speak here today, considering that everything that has been said has been said, that had need to be said has been said. I simply would like to associate myself with the words, with the record of Senator Angara, and hope that we could all try to come close to what he has achieved in his lifetime. For he was a man who came from us. From the province of Baler, he rose and, you know, sought forever a newer world in his life. He defined himself by such a heuristic notion to uplift his fellow man. That is why his record speaks for itself in education, in business, in justice, creating a law firm par excellence, and certainly creating the relationships that would never, never be erased from the history of our country. And let me just say today that, if I may quote from Psalms, after Pastor Abilinaiva has already spoken, good men must die, but death cannot kill their names. Of course not. And so today, I would like to say that Edgardo and Angara and I shared a lot of visions, struggles, and triumphs together. We started together in the Constitutional Convention almost 48 years ago. He claimed that he was one of the youngest. I was the youngest. And certainly because of that, there was a common bond between us, very idealistic, and always trying to achieve what was impossible. We thought that the impossible, as Napoleon once said, would take a little longer to achieve. And so, through the years, when we were in the CONCON, we voted to ban Mr. Marcos at that time together, but we collided when it came to the Constitution in many respects in the future. But let me just say today that Senator Angara and I cemented our relationship when martial law was declared. My mother was harassed at that time by a certain general, one of the most powerful ones, Tomas Diaz, who was a relative of our congressman at that time, and my mother was brought to Camp Olivas. I went to Senator Enrile, who at that time was a Minister of Defense, and I said I'd like to go to Camp Olivas, but I want to make sure that I would go back and get out. Ed Angara was with me, and he said, Dick, I will accompany you. Without flinching, without hesitation, we went together. And he gave me the courage to speak my mind. And boy, did I speak my mind that day. I wasn't afraid because my friend was beside me. And forever we became friends since then. So a debt that I would never be able to repay because we were able to get my mother out because of the injustice brought upon her by martial law at that time. But let me say, it did not end there as well. We went on and the Constitutional Convention, and by the time the Constitutional Convention was over, he said, why don't you join me in my law firm? And I said, I'm not yet a lawyer, Ed. Maybe afterwards. And later on, indeed, when I finished and went back to law school, I wanted to join him in Accra. I did not tell him I was joining. And of course, his fraternity brothers, all Sigma Rowans in that law firm, you know, told me, specifically Teddy Angara, Ted Regala said, you know, we're all Sigma Rowans here, you know? I said, yes, I know. It only takes one Epsilonian to take care of all of you. And this would be a back and forth. Frank Delona, Raul Rocco, you know, Rene Caetano, we were all there together, and we worked together. Worked hard, long hours, and we played hard. We went to Bombers, we shared drinks. I never drank, so I never got drunk. Ed Angara never got drunk. But we always had great times, great stories to tell. I would like to talk about the Angara that very few people knew. You know, he was quiet, and yet he was substantial. He thought well. He had vision. A man who could see things far ahead and saw a vision of a life better than what is today. And so when I became mayor of Olongapo, and before I became mayor, I had to leave Accra, and I was asked to go and run for the Batasan Pambansa, which I did not do so. He called me and he told me, I will assign you to the Legislative Research Group. You remember, Frank? And we started a section in the law firm for helping our clients in Congress. That gave me a lot of opportunity to be exposed to congressmen and the Senate. And when I became mayor, of course, Ed, by that time, had become president of the University of the Philippines after we helped him become president of the IBP, president of the ASEAN Law Association, a Filipino, creating an ASEAN Law Association, and winning, and at the same time making a difference in ASEAN law. I asked him, maybe he might want to set up the University of the Philippines branch in Olongapo. And he indeed, he came many pounds ago, you can see. Is that there? Yeah, many pounds ago. And many inches ago. And indeed it happened, and it still does, and something that the Philippine people of Olongapo will never forget. in the middle of our in the midst of our years, middle of during our middle years, the controversial basis debate happened, and Edong and I took the same side together. He always had a pragmatic view of what the future should be, not something that we could just talk about and without thinking of the repercussions on the people and on our security. And indeed, he asked me to join him, and we had that big, big rally in the Luneta. We all got wet. That also reconciled me with Cory Aquino, and we all walked to the Senate. And I remember Ed and I, sabay pa kami nagsabi, sabi ni Senator Salonga, okay, we will consider your proposal on the basis. And he was smiling like, the great Senator Salonga was smiling like he swallowed the Cheshire cat, swallowed the canary, or whatever you want to call it. And both Ed and Garan said, after Cory Aquino said, oh, we can go now. Mom, we have not gotten anything yet from the Senate. And indeed, we didn't. But we never gave up. We came back here, and who was going to help me fix up Subic? Of course, Senator Enrile and Senator Angara were some of the very few senators who really understood what the Freeport was at that time. And Senator Angara helped me again, and when it happened, he was there during the inaugural of the new Subic, and we created a newer world, strengthened again by my friendships with some of the Sigmarowans, but most of the people who have helped me here in creating Subic Bay. Many, many things have happened ever since. In the later years, when we were together in the Senate, as Vic said, and I don't believe everything that makes us is a tendency to exaggerate, but the friendship was never exaggerated. We had great times here, and we'd always be the bantering between Sigmaro and Upsilon. I would not mention that story with Joker Arroyo and me on one side, and Eddie Angara and Frank Pilon and Enrile on the other side. But let me just say that during those times, we were always together. I can't remember what Senator Subir was talking about, that we had a misunderstanding. The only time I remember we had a misunderstanding was fixed when Senator Subir himself indeed talked to Senator Angara and told him that, in spite of the fact that nagagalit ka, Senator Gordon went to see, Tito Dick went to see Tito Johnny and said, panalo ka naman na, tama na. And Eddie, I will never forget what he said. He came over to me and said, ikaw Dick talagang kaibigan ka, hindi ka nag-iiwan. And indeed, that was the nature of our friendship. Di kami nag-iiwan. We knew how to react to each other. We knew when we had to work together. And indeed, when I would talk to him later on, when Sonny Angara had become Senate, and I can tell you, I want to reveal our ages here with Frank. Sonny Angara and his sisters, Kasha, Alex, they would come over to the office, and they were tights. Even Pia Cayetano and Peter Cayetano, they were tights. And today, when I talked to Senator Angara, I told him, Ed, magaling yung anak mo, no? Nagmana kay Baby Angara, sabi ko sa kanya. And he would chuckle and he would smile, and you could see his face light up. Indeed, he loved his family. Indeed, he wanted more time. But sabi nga nila, the woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have promised to keep and miles to go before I sleep, sabi ni Robert Frost. And indeed, that was the way Angara and most of us in Accra and most of us who work in the Senate do. Long hours of working. Sometimes, we never forget our families, at least we claim. We love our families, at least we claim. But believe you me, we do. And Ed Angara loved Baby, loved his family, loved Edong. And I remember my daughter calling me up last week, Papa, mabuti pa si Tito Ed. He was here. He was taking care of his grandson. He and Javier were here in Hong Kong. Wow. That hit me. Big time. And I think Frank was with him. That's something that I salute the man for. Ed Angara will be remembered for many things he has done for our country. My God, senior citizens, education, TESDA, everything, you name it, the man did it. Quietly, not with force, but with constant diplomacy, with a smile in his face, with peace in his heart, reaching out to everybody. And as he said, don't have to quarrel everybody, we will all be friends afterwards. And indeed, that was he was, a perfect diplomat. So when our president sometimes cusses and bristles with all kinds of words, Ed Angara is in Europe talking with the European Union. calling me and telling me, ikaw dito, ako doon. And I think the ambassador of the EU is here and will testify to that. I talk with the EU here, Senator Angara talks with the EU there, and then we talk together and we try to get the EU closer to us. Why? Because he thinks of his beloved Baler. He thinks of every Filipino must have a fighting chance, a chance to be what they could be. Just as Eddie Angara, a simple guy from the province of Baler, you know, fully imbibed with history of President Quezon, his relations, wanting to make a future for the country and pushing the future aside to make sure that it will let him pass, to make sure we can get that wonderful day when the Filipino will stay proud and remain proud. And so today, the whole country must remember him. Our words here will be forgotten, but it behooves all of us, every young man and woman in this country in the schools, must remember what he did and what he did for them, and must remember that without him, hindi magara ang kinabukasan ng bayan. Kaya minsan pinag-iisip ako, you know, I say, siguro my father named me Richard. Rich the hard way, he would always tell me. Ed Angara, education, Ed Angara, palaging magara ang education. Javier, St. Francis Xavier. And when you put that all together, it creates a definition of the man. A man who pushed aside everything else to make sure the future would happen. No Sigmaro, no Upsilon, no parties, no nothing. Just one heuristic notion of creating a newer world. Forever creating a newer world, giving every Filipino a fighting chance. And I'm sorry, Rene Sagisag, you stole my line from Henry Wordsworth. He fills the world with radiance. Sabi nga nila, he light up my life. I mean, I will just say it again because I want to say it. It's my favorite for reserved for special friends like Edo. Henry Wordsworth, though nothing can bring back the hour of splendor of the grass, of glory in the flowers, we will grieve not, but rather find strength from what remains behind. Let us celebrate Ed Angara. He is our hero. Thank you all very much.
The Honorable Lauren Legarda will now deliver her eulogy.
To the bereaved family of former Senate President Edgardo Angara, Mrs. Gloria Angara, Sunny and Tutsi, Anna, Katia, Alex, Congresswoman Belia, Angara Castillo, other brothers and sisters and family, and the dear Apos, our sincerest condolences. How do I even start honoring a man so accomplished on wide-ranging issues and advocacies? It seems there was no issue he did not know about, as exemplified or talked about eloquently by Dick, by Migs, by Testaman, and all of that. How do we choose the words to describe him and the life he lived? They've said it all. Pia, even the best words would seem too humbling for someone so great. It's not easy to eulogize, lest I miss out on so many accomplishments or even overshoot the time allotted to me, because Frank Drilon is counting the time allotted to everyone. That's why he said stick to our written speech. Because there's just so much to say, right, Pia? So allow me to just read this prepared eulogy, although this in itself is just a speck in the universe, because no amount of words will suffice. No statement or article or eulogy can ever live up to the great man that he was, or to the accomplishments of such a life well lived. You were infecting me, Pia. Allow me to start my eulogy with a very important announcement. Starting this school year, Filipinos who have graduated from high school, Bam Aquino, and Sherwin, and Migs were all authors, and Sunny, can now access free college education in all of the country's state universities and colleges, local universities and colleges, state-owned technical vocational institutions.
This has been a long-time dream of many underprivileged Filipinos. Thanks to the Universal Access to Quality Tertiary Education Act, more Filipinos will now have a chance to get a bachelor's degree and have a better chance in life. Why am I saying this? Ed is no longer senator. This is truly something we can all be happy and proud of for our nation and our fellow Filipinos. But this would not have been possible. And we, the authors and sponsors of the law, half of the Senate, would not have done this if not for a much earlier intervention, 3 decades ago. On May 26, 1988, Republic Act number 6655, long before many of us became senator, or the Free High School Act, was signed into law, which allowed even the poorest of the poor to gain access to secondary education. It was authored by the man whose well-lived life we honor today in this august chamber that had been his home for at least 4 terms as legislator. Former Senate President Edgardo Javier Angara, or Ed, to us, his colleagues, was an education advocate, and in that sphere alone, he was already able to introduce measures and reforms that have greatly shaped the country's educational system. Already mentioned, but I will say it again, the author of laws creating the Commission on Higher Education, the TESDA, the Government Assistance to Students and Teachers in Private Education, or GASPE. But prior to the enactment of these laws, however, he had already established a sterling reputation as a man who had the vision to improve Philippine education when he was president of the University of the Philippines. His initiatives were not merely focused on upholding the reputation of UP as a country's premier university, but also in establishing a perfect rapport with the students at a most difficult time. Yes, he was a very accomplished lawyer, established ACRA, one of the finest legal institutions in the country with the best brilliant minds, esteemed legislator, a statesman. But he had always maintained a connection with the people. Maybe because even with all his achievements, he had always considered himself, in the words of Nick Joaquin, a provinciano. He dearly loved his home province, Baler, its people, including the Dumagats, the indigenous people of Aurora. But his love for the IPs was not limited to the Dumagats alone. He had deep respect for all our indigenous peoples. He had deep appreciation for our indigenous culture bearers, which actually led him to create the National Living Treasures Award, a prestigious recognition for exceptional traditional Filipino artists. He was a patron of the arts and a passionate cultural worker who authored and sponsored laws creating the National Museum, the NCCA, and the National Cultural Heritage Law. His dedication to his causes was unmatched, and I'm honored to have been able to work with him closely on shared advocacies, on education, on healthcare, on agriculture, on culture, on environment, on climate, and many more. Ed was a statesman, embracing public service as a badge of honor. A visionary, he worked tirelessly so that national interests reigned paramount over parochial concerns. Ed was a man who had his heart in the right place. He engaged in fruitful, meaningful, soulful, substantial debates in the Senate, but also immersed himself in philanthropic activities for the benefit of the underprivileged, the vulnerable, and the needy. He knew how to communicate with people in his own quiet, humble way from all walks of life. But he was also an eloquent communicator with the environment. Indeed, he was a lover of the forests and the seas. No one can doubt his sincerity in the causes he had espoused. And one cannot likewise resist the urge to smile or even laugh when he shows his wit. Once, when I greeted him on his birthday, he replied, "Whose birthday? It's been deleted for being overdue." Then one time, I got this message on a text. "My food supply has dried up. The food chain has been interrupted." Apparently, he was just asking me to send over, which I think Sani and Tutsi and Gloria enjoy as well, the adobo and paksiw na bangus, which I regularly send close friends and colleagues, and the favorite salads in Kai. Ed had an interest in everything, from admiring a Dumagat baby in the Casalarin Cove, to relishing baby lechon or cochinillo, his favorite, with Tita Sally. From organizing community choirs and artist communes, to collecting placemats, plates, towels, and little things for the house and the kitchen, to discussing science and technology and constitutional issues, and just recently the blue economy and carbon pricing, and the Philippine-EU cooperation agreement, which I so gladly sponsored and passed in the Senate. I will have to agree with the late grand old man of Philippine literature, national artist Nick Joaquin, when he wrote in his book, Ed Angara, Seer of Sea and Sierra, and I quote, "Ed Angara, a senator, had range and relevance. His attention is wide-ranging, his relevance instantaneous," unquote. Truly, Ed had a great mind with a noble heart. He was a statesman who proudly remained a provinciano. For sure he will be missed. His sudden departure leaves a gaping hole in his beloved Aurora, where his towering presence had served as a powerful inspiration to the young to pursue excellence as a way of life. On the national stage, his absence will be felt long after his body will be laid to rest. Today is truly a sad day in the Senate, his second home, for the Filipino people whom he served till his dying breath. The passing of Ed marks the end of an era, but his legacy lives on. We may have lost one of the Philippines' most brilliant minds, but he left an indelible mark not only in this nation's history, but also in the life of every Filipino who has benefited and will benefit from his lifelong work as a public servant. It's been said, but I will say it again. Ed, yours is a life well lived. Thank you for your untiring service to our country. Thank you for all.
I have often dreamed of a far-off place where a great warm welcome will be waiting for me, where the crowds will cheer when they see my face, and the voice keeps saying, "This is where I'm meant to be. I will find my way. I can go the distance. I'll be there someday. If I can be strong, I know every mile will be worth my while. I would go most anywhere to find where I belong." Where the crowds will cheer when they see my face, and a voice keeps saying, "This is where I'm meant to be. I will find my way. I can go the distance. I'll be there someday. If I can be strong, I know every mile will be worth my while. I would go most anywhere to find where I belong."
The Honorable Franklin M. Drilon will now deliver his eulogy.
Today, we honor Edgardo Javier Angara and his extraordinary life and work that inspired countless men and women, even as we extend our deepest sympathies to the baby, his wife, his children, Anna, our colleague Sunny, Katya, and Alex. But we cannot deny that the passing of this gentleman, who made an indelible mark in this great institution, has left us all with a void that is so difficult to fill. Ed's passing came as a shock to me, as I'm sure it did to most of us here today. When I first heard the news, it felt like the rug was pulled out from my feet. Ed and I had breakfast in Hong Kong, Shangri-La Hotel, 2 Sundays ago. And last Saturday, I was one of the last people who saw Ed and enjoyed his company just hours before he quietly passed on. After attending the 46th anniversary of Akron Law at the Gaytay Highlands last Saturday, Ed hosted a merienda cena at his house in Tagaytay. He was in a jovial mood and seemed to be in good health, and talked animatedly about his life away from politics. He even showed us his art house, newly built, where he planned to put on display his memorabilia. I kidded him, "Ed, 83 ka na, sa dami mo pang gawin, siguro dapat hanggang 183 years old ka para matapos mo lahat mo na plano." Little did I know that his earthly journey would soon come to an end in a few hours after we parted ways. But still I am grateful that he shared his time, or whatever was left of it, with us. Summarizing my friendship with Ed of almost 50 years in such a short speech is impossible, as we have collected many memories, too many to recall each one of them. Ed was many things to me. We were not only fraternity brothers, we also worked together from Accra to the Senate and shared countless milestones. I was even there in the baptismal lunch of his son, Sunny Angara, in 1972. It is therefore hard to pick out my best memory of our friendship that spans for several decades. Ed was a jewel of a friend, a man who had my highest respect and admiration. It is not a secret that he was a major influence in my professional and political life. It was Ed who invited me to Accra. He convinced me that since Accra was a new firm then, it would offer bigger opportunities for me as a young professional. Accra was then looking for someone who was in labor practice. Even before they recruited me, Ed asked me for my advice on some labor cases that the firm was handling. I even remember I was not in Accra, but I appeared in a case representing Accra Law. Working in Accra indeed was an excellent career move made possible by Ed. Barely a few months after my election to the Senate in 1995, there was a change in leadership. Ed, who was then Senate President, was replaced. With nary a thought of my nascent political career, I threw my full support to Ed. For standing by him, I was left with no committee to handle. But it was all worth it. I then joined the opposition group that Senator Ed then led, along with then Senator, former Senate President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, Senators Ople, Tatad, and Flavier. I gave the same unstinting support to Ed when he ran for Vice President in 1998 under former President Erap Estrada. Our friendship transcended political colors and affiliations, even if sometimes we find ourselves opposing each other and sitting in opposite political fences. Once, Ed even tried to depose me as Senate President. But the friendship remained. Leaders and politicians come and go, but only a few would leave deep footprints in the sand of time because of their enormous contribution to nation building and to the betterment of humanity. Ed's sterling achievements in the fields of politics, public service, law, and the academe cemented his niche in our nation's life and history. The impact of laws he authored, such as the Free High School Act, the creation of CHED and TESDA, the Senior Citizens Act, the PhilHealth Act, and so many others, will be deeply felt and appreciated by generations of Filipinos. His journey on earth was marked by his courage and determination to pursue his vision for our country, as well as his deep reservoir of ideas on how to uplift the lives of our countrymen. I am privileged to have known him, to have laughed, to have walked, to have worked with him. It is not easy to bid him farewell, but I find comfort in the thought that his life was well lived. In his lifetime, he enriched many lives, including mine. To Gloria, Anna, Sunny, Katya, and Alex, you lost a great husband and an amazing father. I lost a dear friend and an esteemed colleague. Our country may have lost one of its brilliant and illustrious sons, but I am certain that Ed's legacy is cradled in the bosom of a grateful nation. While we would all prefer that he remained with us, Ed Angara now belongs to the ages. And this is how I would like to envision my dear Edong now. In peace and at rest, but still strong and sure, and watching over us with a curious but satisfied grin. While all that we have left are now fond memories, we can rest in the fact that he was a life well lived. Today, we come to express our sympathy, respect, and affection for Ed, his loved ones, and share their loss and pain. Just like a heavy load, grief that is shared loses its sting and dissipates among loving friends and family. It dissipates because each will carry away with us not the burden of grief, but pleasant and wonderful memories of Ed. It is soothing and healing to realize that Ed touched the lives of so many, where he has sown so much goodwill and affection. So let us spread Ed's loving memory and good deeds to honor him and help ease our shared pain of losing a dear friend and colleague. Paalam, Ed. Thank you for your gift of friendship. Rest in eternal peace. May God's face shine upon your soul, the family you left behind, and the Philippines that you deeply love.
The Honorable Vicente C. Soto III will now deliver his eulogy.
The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. God shared with us the time, talent, and service of Edgardo Javier Angara for 83 years. And he chose to return him to the embrace of our mother on the feast day of Our Lady of Fatima, May 13, Mother's Day this year. SEJA is how he is fondly called within these halls, acronym for Senator Edgardo J. Angara. Sa aking pong paglalakbay sa larangan ng pambansang politika, siya ang isa sa aking nililingon na pinanggalingan mula sa pagiging Vice Mayor ng Quezon City. Binigyan niya ako ng puwang upang makasami sa kanyang partido, ang LDP, na kumandidato bilang sa pagkasenador noong 1992, kasabay ni President Gloria. At noong 1998, magkasama na naman kami, kasama naman si President Erap, at di na kami nagkahiwalay mula noon sa larangan ng politika. Maraming dahon na rin ang nalagas sa tangkay ng panahon, ngunit hindi ko malilimutan ang mga pagkakataong naibigay niya sa akin. He was architect and engineer of many of our social institutions, laying the foundations on which stand the pillars of nations, or the nation's law on health, or laws on health, education, social justice, culture, and the arts. He opened the doors of the classroom to all, knowing that a good education is the great equalizer of chances and opportunities. He had a style all his own, with the gentle moves and soft voice that turn belligerent opponents into long-lost friends. He insinuated past events without us realizing that he was teaching history, Filipino soldiery, and the pride of place on Baler through a movie called Baler. He took us back to the 300 years of Philippine-Spanish-Mexican commerce and relations through a book on the galleon and exhibiting even a replica. And he soothed frayed foreign nerves with his innate diplomacy and modesty. His instrument for justice was the law, and his Accra Law office was a veritable foundry shop of senators who once worked for the law firm. No eloquence nor oratorical prowess here today can match the speech delivered by the life well lived by Senator Ed. His legacy is also his acronym, SEJA, which stands for Senate Dedicated to Education, Justice, and Arts. Fare thee well, SEJA. Colleague, mentor, patriot, Filipino, we are comforted by the thought that for the many things that you have left for the country, you have left us with an able proxy in his own right, Senator Sani Angara, a worthy son of a worthy father. Salamat Ed, paalam.
The Honorable Ralph G. Recto will now deliver his eulogy.
Call a politician productive, and it would be dismissed as hyperbole. But use it to describe Ed Angara, and it comes off as an understatement. Ed's output of laws is encyclopedic, and the records of this institution will bear me out that such is no exaggeration. So much so that if the laws passed after EDSA 1 will be indexed by authorship, like the Bible, the Book of Edom will be the most voluminous. Not only are these laws many, they are meritorious. Today, they are valued as national assets. Unfortunately for him, laws one had crafted cannot be reported as assets in one Sal-N. Otherwise, he would have been the richest senator in history. Ed was never a one-issue lawmaker, but a multidisciplinary one. And each of the laws that was polished to brilliance by his wisdom has been improving the lives of those who benefit from it. Because of Ed, Filipinos are born to this world covered with medical insurance and are sent off to eternal life with discounted services. In between, they can be enrolled in free kindergarten, thanks to him, and high school became universal through a landmark law of his. The laws on education he authored were so many that they require a separate catalog. He passionately believed that any child, like the Promdi from Baler that he was, can go as far and as fast in life as his education can take him. His Angara ng Kinabukasan, kung may pinag-aralan, was not just his campaign slogan. It was his fighting faith, which became the nation's mission. I once joked to him that not one of the laws he had authored is immune to change, but this timeless slogan he had coined will never be repealed. He also turned his chamber into a classroom. The time he spent here became a teaching moment, not only for the country, but more so for his colleagues. Because in the absence of a school for lawmaking, the next best thing were the free tutorials, which he generously imparted whenever he was speaking on the floor. While education was his banner advocacy, he was just as prolific, as proficient, and as passionate in crafting laws aimed at helping the troubled and the distressed, or give hope to those with promise and potential. And the way Ed argued this without being disagreeable betrayed a first-rate mind that was neither constricted by partisanship nor prone to propaganda. One day he can be discussing banking terms in boardroom speak, and the next day he can be explaining fertilizer formula in the lingua franca of the magsasaka. One minute he will be fielding questions on pensions with the skill of an actuarian, and the next hour he will be lecturing on the Spanish rule like a tenured historian. He can dissect the fine print of the law he had read up with the same ease that he can describe the brush strokes of the art he owned. Yet he was able to amass a trove of laws and thrive in policy making in a manner that seems to violate every canon in today's playbook of politics. He was a workhorse in a stable, in a Senate of show horses, where the rule is to strut and prance before the public. He plodded on in silence, away from TV camera lights. He never dallied likes, neither did he fuss over shares. He was more concerned with the fine print of the law than the size of the headlines he never chased. If there was one thing he relentlessly pursued, it was a record of selfless service and a score of laws unlike today, when the race is on who can post the most number of selfies. Polite and courteous, he fought great causes without having to utter a single curse in public, as he saw no need to punctuate the point he was making with coarseness. At a time when speeches are measured by loudness, not logic, he spoke calmly and ditched oratory. In fact, his speech bordered on the bland, but what he lacked in bombast, he made up through powerful arguments which were impossible to ignore. at a time when the trolls force politicians to merely say what everybody believes, but in a loud voice, he had the courage to defy the wisdom of the crowd with views which may not be popular, but right. At a time when debates are viewed as a chance to simply parade the supremacy of one's position, he, on the other hand, genuinely saw them as an opportunity to enrich the end product through a discussion that generates light rather than heat. At a time when winner-take-all seems to be the norm, he conceded when he was wrong and sought consensus to break stalemates, for he believed that progress was a product of give and take. He knew when to stand ground and when to seek common ground. And that is what the nation will miss about Ed the most, the man at the center. Because only those who seek the middle ground will be able to operate the fulcrum that moves things, balances interests, and prevents deadlock as what he had masterfully done. There is another facet of the man worth remembering and emulating, and that is to respect divergence in beliefs, value the contribution of the opposition, and harness contrarian views in improving policy. My dear friends, since he ended this quarter of a century of hard labor in this chamber 5 years ago, I would still bump into him in different places, and every time we met, I would tease him as the elder Angara and refer to his son Sonny as the better Angara. And like a homeroom teacher, I would proceed to dutifully report to him how the better Angara had been faring great in his old haunts. And hearing this, he would, without fail, break into a smile, followed by a glint in his eye that could only mean fatherly pride. And perhaps in his ledger of life's work, having raised children who can better your best is an accomplishment greater than leaving a world that is better than when you have found it. Seated here, ladies and gentlemen, are Ed's children and Apos, whom he and Gloria raised well, and who have become his grandest achievement, as well as his greatest source of joy. Godspeed, Ed. You have fought the good fight. Rest well, and we would know that you have been taken into God's good graces if one day we will receive a communique from heaven that the Ten Commandments have been amended to become 20. For such only be a handiwork of yours.
The Senate Secretary, Lutgardo B. Barbo, will now read the Senate resolution.
Republic of the Philippines, Congress of the Philippines, Senate, Pasay City, 17th Congress, Second Regular Session, Resolution Number 105, resolution expressing the profound sympathy and sincere condolences of the Senate on the demise of former Senate President Edgardo J. Angara. Whereas the Honorable Edgardo J. Angara, a distinguished public servant, a statesman, legislator, patriot, educator, banker, lawyer, art patron, and farmer, passed away on May 13, 2018 at the age of 83. Whereas the illustrious and colorful career as a public servant spanned almost five decades, with him serving as a delegate in the 1971 Constitutional Convention, President of the University of the Philippines, Senator, Senate President, Chairman of the Commission on Appointments, Senate Minority Leader, Chairman of the Philippine National Bank, Secretary of Agriculture, Executive Secretary, and a Special Envoy to the European Union, whereas born to a middle-class family in Baler, Aurora. The bright young Edong was a product of the public school system and later obtained his Bachelor of Laws degree from the University of the Philippines in 1958 and Master of Laws as a Clyde Alton DeWitt Fellow from the University of Michigan in 1964, whereas for his exemplary performance as a law student, he became a member of the Order of the Purple Heather, the UP College of Law Honor Society, and to International Honor Societies, the Phi Kappa Phi and Phi Gamma Mu. Whereas as a young lawyer, he first worked as an assistant attorney in a major law firm, and after gaining extensive knowledge, ability, and experience in the practice of law, co-founded Angara, Abellio, Concepcion, Regala, and Cruz Law in 1972, whereas for his outstanding leadership and achievements as a law practitioner and public servant, he was elected president of various law organizations such as the Philippine Bar Association, Integrated Bar of the Philippines, Association of Southeast Asian Nation Law Association, and Southeast Asia Parliamentarians Against Corruption. Whereas as president of UP, he indefatigably exerted efforts to uphold the university's reputation for academic excellence as the country's premier educational center, demonstrating unrelenting concern and persistence in upgrading the standards of the academy, in vastly improving the financial and human resources of the state university, in rationalizing the tuition fees for the financially disadvantaged students, in defending its tradition of dissent and fiscal autonomy, and in establishing stronger links with the business community and alumni organizations, both domestic and abroad, whereas in his honor, the UP Board of Regents created the UP President Edgardo J. Angara Fellowship Program in 2008, under which outstanding members of the faculty may pursue research and studies on policy matters involving great public interest. Whereas, as Secretary of the Department of Agriculture, he was the chief steward in increasing production, increasing markets, correcting policy biases, and promoting the cause of agriculture and fisheries. Whereas, he was a recipient of numerous awards, recognitions, and citations, local and international, notably UP's Most Distinguished Alumnus Award, UP College of Law's Highest Professional Award, Quezon Province Medalya ng Karangalan, Aurora Province Dangal ng Aurora Award for Public Service, IBP's Lifetime Achievement Award, Spain Premio Casa Asia in 2010, France Commandeur Dong Lord de Palme Medal, Singapore's Lee Kuan Yew Fellow, and Japan's Cordon of the Rising Sun. Whereas firmly believing that it is the duty of the people to ensure free, orderly, and honest elections, he actively participated in the organization of the National Citizens Movement for Free Elections, which served as the election watchdog in the 1986 snap elections. Whereas after the 1986 EDSA People Power Revolution and the ratification of the 1987 Constitution, he ran in the 1987 senatorial election and ranked fifth among the 24 senators who were elected. Whereas as senator, he chaired various committees, mostly notably the Congressional Commission on Education and the Congressional Commission on Agricultural Modernization. Whereas throughout his long and productive career as a legislator, he consistently advocated for and authored landmark legislation that made a direct impact on the lives of millions of Filipinos, particularly laws on agriculture, education, health, arts and culture, science and technology, good governance, financial reforms and social welfare, such as the Free High School Education Act, the Government Assistance to Students and Teachers in Private Education Act, the Generics Act, the National Health Insurance Act, the Senior Citizens Act, the Agricultural and Fisheries Modernization Act, the Government Procurement Reform Act, the Renewable Energy Act, the Commission on Higher Education, the Technical Education and Skill Development Authority, the Magna Carta for Public Health Workers, the National Museum Act of 1998, the National Commission on Culture and the Arts, the Natatanging Manlilikha Award, the Ombudsman Law, the National Cultural Heritage Law, and the establishment of the Aurora Special Economic Zone Authority, which was later changed to Aurora Pacific Economic Zone and Freeport Authority, whereas, as Senate President, he maintained his reputation as a resolute reformer and firm leader by guiding the Senate through one of the most productive moments in its history, encouraging the members of the upper chamber to introduce vital economic and social reform laws that brought the country's economic and social regime towards sustainable growth and more equitable development, whereas the demise of a great leader and true champion of the people's fundamental rights and is a great loss to the nation, whereas the members of this august chamber join the whole nation and his family in their moment of bereavement over the departure of a great man and esteemed public servant, now therefore be it resolved by the Senate of the Philippines to express, as it hereby expresses, its profound sympathy and sincere condolences on the demise of former Senate President Edgardo J. Angara. Resolved further that a copy of this resolution be transmitted to the bereaved family of former Senate President Edgardo J. Angara, adopted, signed, Aquilino Coco Pimentel III, President of the Senate. This resolution was adopted by the Senate on May 15, 2018, signed Secretary of the Senate.
The Senate President, together with the incumbent senators, will now present the resolution to the family of the late Senator Edgardo J. Angara. The Honorable Aquilino Coco Pimentel III, Senate President, will now deliver his eulogy.
Former Presidents Estrada and Macapagal Arroyo, my dear colleagues in the Senate, former senators, our Senate family, the Angara and Javier families, to all the friends and supporters of Senator Ed Angara, a blessed noon to all of you. Today, as we pay tribute and celebrate the life of a former colleague, we demonstrate with all sincerity how much we treasure the memory of the character, the spirit, and the legacy of former Senate President Edgardo J. Angara. Senator Angara was a distinguished public servant, statesman, legislator, educator, banker, lawyer, art patron, and farmer. He had an illustrious and eventful career as a public servant which spanned 5 decades from delegate to the 1971 Constitution all the way to being appointed as our country's special envoy to the European Union in 2017. Along the way, he held various positions, President of Philippine Bar Association, IBP, Association of Southeast Asian Nation Law Association, President of the UP, Senator, Senate President, Chairman of the Commission on Appointment, Senate Minority Leader, Chairman of the Philippine National Bank, Secretary of Agriculture, Executive Secretary, Senator again, and then President of the Southeast Asian Parliamentarians Against Corruption. Senator Ed Angara was born to a middle-class family in Baler, Aurora, and through sheer hard work, industry, and study, as a product of our public school system, rose to the upper echelons of government and society. He even co-founded one of the most famous and successful law firms in the country, Accra Law, in 1972. For all of us not born with a silver spoon in one's mouth, Senator Ed Angara can and should serve as an inspiration and a role model that success in what we have involved ourselves with can be achieved through hard work, industry, and study, coupled with a clear vision and the ability to form and work with a competent team. Now let me address my colleagues in the Senate, especially the younger ones, and there are many of them. More than half of the Senate is younger than me. Senator Ed Angara's achievements should inspire us in our work. We should all look up to him as a paragon of what a senator of our republic should be. As a lawmaker, the laws he authored, sponsored, or supported made a significant impact in the fields of education, health, social welfare, agriculture, good governance, energy, environment, and even culture and arts. Name it, and he had contributed to it. In particular, he was instrumental in the creation of the Technical Skills and Development Authority, TESDA, and the Commission on Higher Education. I agree with Tito Ed that education is the great equalizer. It is our best weapon in the fight against ignorance and poverty. As enumerated in our Senate resolution, the legislative achievements of Senator Angara show us that he was a complete, multifaceted, multi-talented, indefatigable, visionary senator. And as Senate President, he was instrumental in the creation of the Legislative Executive Development Advisory Committee, or the LEDAC. Senator Edgardo J. Angara's life on earth was never idle. With definitive sense of purpose, this man pursued his mission to the end, wasting no time. We will miss him, but we will continue to be inspired by him. Thank God that his dutiful son and worthy successor, Senator Sunny Angara, who is Mr. Education himself, is a colleague of ours. He will be our constant reminder of the message and legacy of our departed, dearly beloved Senate leader. So Tito Ed, paalam po sa iyo at maraming salamat po sa mahaba at matagumpay na serbisyo sa bayan.
On behalf of the family of the late Senator Edgardo J. Angara, the Honorable Sunny Angara will deliver the response.
Mr. President, Senate President Coco Pimentel, sa ating mga dating Pangulo, mahal na Pangulo, President Erap, President Gloria Macapagal-Arroyo, sa ating dating Vice Presidente Noli Cabayan de Castro, sa ating Senate President pro tempore Ralph Recto, Senate Majority Leader Tito Soto, Senate Minority Leader and the longest serving Senate President in the post-EDSA Revolution era, Senator Franklin Drilon, Senator Lauren, all the dear friends, my barkada and the seatmates, Senator Pia, former colleagues, Senator Ping, Senator Greg, all these great names. It's like a veritable pantheon of Philippine politics, Senator Dick, Senator Miggs. On behalf of our family, my mother, Gloria, my sisters, Anna, Katya, Alex, my wife, Tutsi, my dad's grandchildren, Manolo, Ines, Javier, and Finn, Joe, his siblings, Congresswoman Belia, Mayor Arthur, his nephews and nieces, his former staff who he loved dearly, kahit minumura po kayo, mahal po kayo. Kami din po. He was our biggest critic, but he was also our greatest supporter. Ganun po ang karinyo ng aking tatay. Alam niyo po yun. Sa member ng kabinete, I saw Secretary Bello here earlier. Yusek Carl Chua is here. Members of the diplomatic corps. To the Senate staff who he loved dearly and worked with for over 2 decades. Sa lahat po ng mamamayang Pilipino ngayon nandito. Salamat po sa lahat ng tributes. We learned so much, and everything you said is like a memory, a golden memory that we will treasure for as long as we live. We will certainly keep this dear to our heart. I'd like to say some things about my father, and I think baka multuhin po ako pag hindi ko po sinabi. Definitely, he loved the Senate, as Senator Ralph said. He loved its people. He treasured the time he spent here. He called them the best years of his life. And the relationships he formed and the bonds he formed with many of you here meant so much to him. He knew the important role the Senate played in the life of our nation and in improving people's lives. Our father wore many hats and played many roles in his life, as Senator Meek said, a veritable Renaissance man. He was a state university president and educator, a cabinet member, an agriculturist and farmer, a banker, diplomat, lawyer, constitution drafter, NAMFREL chairman, hotelier, patron of the arts as chair of the Metropolitan Museum and Philippine Philharmonic, sports supporter, as mentioned by Senator Pia, book writer and publisher, newspaper column writer, college and law professor, legislator, husband, father, and grandfather. I think his favorite role when he passed was that, the last one I mentioned, as grandfather to his kids. In fact, a week before he passed, he took a trip to Hong Kong with our youngest child, Javier. And his plan was just for him, 83-year-old man, and a 7-year-old grandson to travel to Hong Kong together. And my foolish secretary booked it, the two of them. And imagine if something happened to him. Sino mag-aalaga sa kanya? Yung aking apo. Ay, yung kanyang apo. But I think he was in a good place when he passed, because as Senator Frank said, he spent his last night or his last day on earth with his co-workers, his partners, and his dearest friends. And some of you are here today. So salamat po sa inyo for sharing his life and, as he said, the best years of his life. Sabi nga niya, being in the Senate is like being on a high promontory in the Philippines with an unobstructed view. He was witness to the passage of history and persons, a privileged participant in charting the future of the nation. Sa lahat po ng ito, kung paborito niya po ang magiging lolo, ang pangalawa niyang paborito na at pinakamalaking gampanin niya sa kanyang buhay ay ang pagiging senator at Senate President sa loob ng 23 taon. Dito niyang nagamit ang kanyang angkin, talino at talento na bigay ng Diyos para sa kapakanan ng ating kababayan. I am glad that many of you mentioned his educational reforms, and this was a product of his life and his upbringing. Ang aking ama po ay Laking Baler, isang probinsyano at isa sa mga 10 anak ng doktor at nurse na si Dr. Juan C. Angara at Juana Javier. Both of his parents were among the first graduates of the University of the Philippines, Philippine General Hospital, or UPPGH. But unlike many who chose to practice medicine in the city, their profession, my grandparents took the path less traveled and decided to go back to the small town of Baler and to become what we now call the doctors to the barrios. So that seed of public service was planted early on in my father's life. Tulad ko, idol niya ang kanyang ama na si Dr. Juan C. Angara at ang kanyang kababayan na si dating senador at Pangulo Manuel Luis Quezon na tubong Baler din po. My father's childhood dream was to be a lawyer and to be Secretary of Justice. Safe to say he exceeded his childhood dreams. My father attributed his success to his upbringing and to his education. Lagi po niyang pinagyayabang sa akin na kahit kailan hindi po siya nagbayad ng tuition fee. Scholar daw po siya from UP to Baler Central School, or Baler Central School to UP, UP College of Law, and the University of Michigan. He always emphasized the need to give back, to throw back down the proverbial ladder of opportunity so that more Filipinos and their families could climb out of poverty. Tulad ng sinabi ni Senator Raff, ang campaign slogan niya nung una siyang tumakbo noong 1987 ay Angara ng kinabukasan, pag may pinag-aralan. He took an unconventional route in politics. The most common routes to Senate are through local government, through the cabinet, through the lower house. He was the UP president and NAMFRIL chairman when President Cory personally selected him for her senatorial slate in 1987, a debt of gratitude which he will never forget. Sa muling nabuhay na pambansang demokrasya noong dekada 80, nakita ng aking ama ang mga pangangailangan ng bayan. Unang-una po, ang pagkahina ng mga pambansang institution, politikal, at pangalawa, ang kawalan ng oportunidad para sa pangkaraniwang Pilipino. The challenges for the post-EDSA revolution legislature were immense. Senator Rene are here and they know they tried to rebuild. They were the rebuilders of our democracy, Your Honors. To rebuild democratic and future-oriented institutions, and more importantly, to restore hope and opportunities to a poor and to a divided nation. Kulang po ang oras ngayong araw para pag-usapan ang lahat ng kanyang nailathalang batas, ikwento ang lahat ng kwento, at banggitin ang lahat ng parangal na natanggap ng aking ama. History and the history writers will take care of that. What we request is that all of you here remember our father fondly as a reformer, as an institution builder, as a builder of dreams, an enabler of dreams, an enabler of people. My father was human like everyone else, and if he hurt any of you here, humihingi po kami ng paumanhin. As I said, he had a quick temper. It was never personal with him. It was always born out of a strong will to get things done. Very impatient po ang aking father. So kapag or tuwing napapakinabangan po ng ating mga lolo at lola ang senior citizens card at senior citizens discount, whether sa gamot, sa pagkain, tuwing pag-enroll ng bata sa libreng kindergarten o libreng high school, tuwing nakakatipid po ang pamilya dahil sinagot po ng PhilHealth ang parte ng babayarin sa doktor o sa ospital, o tuwing nakakaiwas sa korupsyon dahil merong bidding at merong nakukulong ng mandarambong at nalalabanan ang katiwalian sa gobyerno. Tuwing magbubukas po tayo ng bank account na may pinalaking deposit insurance, tuwing boboto po ang ating mga overseas Filipino workers or OFWs, tuwing kinikilala ang magagaling na Pilipino sa larangan ng sining at kultura, tuwing naipreserba ang ating yamang kultura o heritage, o tuwing may nakakapagtapos ng tech voc o nandahil sa government scholarships, nakakakuha ng diploma, nakakakuha ng magandang trabaho. Sa bawat sandaling mga ito, sana po'y alalahanin at ipagdasal po ninyo ang aming ama na si Ed Angara, a boy from a small town with big dreams and big plans. The boy from Baler who made good and who gave back. A man who loved this country and his people. A man who helped build a better nation for our children and future generations of Filipinos. To all of you, we thank you for sharing his life, his work, his dreams, and aspirations for our country. Salamat po ng lubos. Mabuhay ang Pilipinas.
This necrological service is hereby declared closed.
Without its hunger, each restless heart beats so imperfectly. But when you come and I am filled with wonder, sometimes I think I glimpse eternity.
You raise me up.
May we invite the family, relatives, and friends of the late Senator Edgardo J. Angara to a reception at the Recto Laurel Rooms. May we invite the family, relatives, and friends of the late Senator Edgardo J. Angara to a reception at the Recto Laurel Rooms.